Okay, hallo Leute, wir starten mal wieder in Deutsch. Kraftwerk gegen Beatles, einflussreichste Band aller Zeiten. Wer wird das Rennen machen? Die Beatles gehen natürlich als haushoher Favorit ins Rennen. Kraftwerk in der Außenseiterposition. Aber ich hoffe und ich denke, mit guten Argumenten. So, ich hoffe, Messi taucht jetzt auch auf, sodass wir starten können. Okay, Messi, where are you? Apollo Creed. Beatles Collection. Up with that. There they are. So, Messi, you're well prepared. Impressive.
Have to prepare when it comes to the Beatles. They prepared for us, though. So, Michael Dusseldorf, Maslow in the USA. Unfortunately, I'm not in Liverpool or London. The Beatles, Kraftwerk, a discussion. Is it always a, does it have to be one's better than the other? You know, yes. I mean, in this case, I mean, it's no competition.
In the end, of course. I mean, in the end, of course.
One thing I think that how I want to start this is you and I are about 10 to 12 years apart age-wise.
And I think 11. So.
11, okay. Well, between 10 and 12 is 11 in English, at least. Maybe in German, it's, it's they you guys use kilometers, so it might be different. But in 1960 was basically the beginning of the Beatles. So I grew up, you know, my teen years with the Beatles. Kraftwerk essentially made their first album, the beginning in 1970, 10 years later. So you grew up in the 70s with Kraftwerk being sort of your, I don't want to say a home team, but a band that I assume influenced you. You can.
Yeah. You're right in a way, but it's quite different because, to my knowledge, the Beatles, at least here in Germany, they came with a big bang. It was all about the Beatles, all about. And with Kraftwerk, it was not the same. They were very, very different than anything you have heard before. And my brother-in-law told me that his father did a party in 74, 1974, and he played Kraftwerk. And this was the talk of the party. What is that?
So you're saying
I think that's different.
You're saying that Kraftwerk was doing, what was different that they were doing in 1970? I understand 1974, the first album I got of theirs was a promo copy, which, you know, I'm sure we'll get to later, but this is an American edition of Autobahn. That's the first thing I ever heard, this promo copy of Autobahn. What was so different that you all heard with Kraftwerk that was different than anyone else was doing?
I think the main difference, of course, there has been, of course, electronic music before. People like, for example, Roland Kain, this ivory tower electronic avant-garde music. Karlheinz Stockhausen did something of it. Alvin Lucier with Musique Concrete, but Kraftwerk took it out of the of this ivory tower into popular music, and I can't remember any any song that is comparable to, for example, Autobahn.
Well, okay. A couple things about that. First of all, I'm convinced that Kraftwerk was really invented by George Harrison, because 2 years before Kraftwerk ever put an album out, George Harrison put this album out, Electronic Sound. Look at that. Does that look like a Moog synthesizer to you?
Probably. It was a Moog synthesizer. Yeah.
Now, look at that.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right.
Some would argue, or many have, well, half the album is him with Bernie Krause. Bernie Krause was a half member of Bernie and Krause, a kind of a Bay Area team that got into early electronic music, had records on Warner Brothers Records. Some people, including Bernie, think that George ripped him off because he flew him over to Frere Park in England and said, "Teach me how to use this thing." And George recorded it and put half of it out on a record. So it's George and Bernie doodling on the Moog synthesizer. So I'm saying George Harrison invented Kraftwerk. George Harrison invented Kraftwerk.
And yeah, but if you say so, then you have those early electronic guys. You have had Daphne Oram, you have Paulina Oliveros, but this has nothing to do with Autobahn.
Who's heard about those guys? In fact, those first two Kraftwerk records, 1970, 71, they're just kind of them like experimenting and doodling, right?
Which one you're talking about, Autobahn or the ones before?
No, the first one, 1970 and 71, their first two records. It's kind of like bits and pieces and noodling and doodling. Yeah. Musical.
Yeah, and there's even an album before, they called themselves Organization, but this is very much into improvisation and krautrock. The real start with the electronic music of Kraftwerk is Autobahn. The things they've done before is more in the krautrock, more into the improvisation stuff.
So, okay. So Autobahn, but I'll give it to you. I'll give you this. Okay. This is the, you should show it because I haven't even seen one friggin' Beatle record from you. Jesus Christ.
I have the mono box. I have them all. Okay.
Autobahn is like a road trip, right?
Yeah, no? In a way. Okay, let's call it a road trip. It's awful. Yeah.
Magical Mystery Tour.
Yeah.
Road trip. Which came first? Which came first?
Yeah, but Mezzi, come on. I really, Magical Mystery Tour is a gorgeous album by the Beatles. But musically, they are as different as it can get. Magical Mystery Tour is a very psychedelic album.
It's very psychedelic. And actually, it's really a half of it is a collection of singles. It was an EP in the UK. And half of it are shows from this TV special movie they made. This is actually the German version on Apple.
The Horzu version.
This isn't the Horzu, but the Horzu is the first one that had true stereo of three of the songs on side two, three of the singles. But I mean, you know, okay.
Why do you compare?
You compare because this is like Ochsenscheißen. This is Ochsenscheißen. Was ist das?
Autobahn.
Was ist das?
Autobahn is one of the most important albums of all time. You know, when this one came out, there was nothing like that. Of course, let's say it's a road trip, which isn't, in my opinion, but okay, you can say that. You can't compare Magical Mystery Tour because this is about a road trip with Autobahn.
I am he as you are me and you are we and we are all together, sitting on a cornflake waiting for the van to come. Fun, fun, fun on the Autobahn. Fun,
exactly. Fun, fun, this monotony, the length of the song. How long is the longest song from the Beatles?
Released song, Hey Jude, probably 7 minutes, 11 section, not including Revolution number 9. I think that's longer, but a 7:11.
You really knew it.
I could. I'm impressed. Hey, that's great. I'm not going to get in a fight. I'm not going to get in a fight with some German know-it-all about Kraftwerk, some kind of music that's not even music. It doesn't take talent to twist a few knobs and plug a few things in.
It doesn't take talent. Mazzy. They even built the instruments. They even created the synthesizers. They were doing it. Of course, they have had their Moog, small one, but the rest, they have done it by themselves.
And they have done inventors. They're inventors. Until the end. They're inventors. And I bet you they didn't even use union labor. It was always like they were probably scab labor.
No, probably not, because they would never ever let anybody else than themselves on those instruments. But you put up a very important point, because one of the founders, I think it was Florian, he said we have to work music, and they themselves never considered themselves as musicians. They considered themselves much more as technicians. For them, this technical part was more important than the musical part, you know, which is of course a bit strange.
Okay, let's go back to 1962, Germany, 1962. Did anybody hear of Kraftwerk? Kraftwerk, 1962, where
no
are you?
No one out there.
The Beatles recording My Bonnie with Tony Sheridan in a German studio.
Yeah.
The German were playing live 10, 12 hours a day at the Kaiser Keller, at the Star Club in Germany. And
that was when they did this rock and roll crap, when they sing all the songs from the other artists.
You mean these artists, like, you know, the Everly Brothers and Little Richard and Chuck Berry.
Chuck Berry. Those are great rock and roll, gorgeous.
Gorgeous, outrageous, beautiful.
Yes.
The Beatles live in Hamburg, Germany, where there was these like four guys in Dusseldorf. They didn't even know what a Moog synthesizer was in 1962.
I don't know, maybe. Yeah, but they did their own stuff. Huh? This the workhorses over in Hamburg. Oh my. Was a tough time for them, wasn't it?
Yeah. Let me see your Kraftwerk books. Let me see. Look. You don't have any Kraftwerk books there. I got like...
I don't have Kraft. I listen to their music.
What?
I know them personally.
Oh, well, why don't you tell us about that?
Yeah, there's not much to tell, because they lived in Düsseldorf. I lived in Düsseldorf. And it was not possible to meet them, to not meet them, because we shared the same bakery, the same grocery, the same restaurants and the same clubs.
Fun, and the bakery. Fun.
Yeah, but then, that was quite interesting, because they never have had, at least here in Düsseldorf, this star appeal. It was not so special to see them. Even when they had their number one hits, it was Florian and hi.
Did they have number one hits in Germany?
I think We Are the Robots was one or two. They don't have that much, that many number one hits.
Gentlemen of the jury, but, okay. I rest my case.
No, okay, let's talk about that. Of course, the Beatles sold more albums in a week, probably, than Kraftwerk. But we are talking about influential bands, who created or made other artists, other musicians to do things. And I think that there is that Kraftwerk is in this part a very, very important band. No doubt about it. Okay, we can't, but ask David Bowie, ask Depeche Mode, ask.
I'm asking them, they're not answering.
I ask African Bambaataa, the whole Detroit techno scene, every band which is after Kraftwerk into electronic music owns Kraftwerk a lot. And there is no arguing about that.
I actually agree with you on that. I totally agree with you on that. You know, all those people were in science class that failed at the piano, failed at the guitar. They couldn't handle making music. They plugged in a computer, they turned a switch, and they moved things around. 1964, when the Beatles came after, you know, the big thing here was they came to America and all of a sudden they were huge. They had been, you know, about 2 years percolating in England, put out music, and they were at the top of the charts in the United Kingdom and somewhat in Europe at the time. And when the Beatles came to America, every one of my generation, they picked up a guitar or learned to play drums, and everyone started a band. Every band from the Byrds, you know, Roger McGuinn with the 12-string guitar, all those 12 guitar Rickenbacker bands picked it up because they saw George Harrison playing a Rickenbacker in A Hard Day's Night. I think you froze. You see, Michael is right now is frozen, and he's doing music that Kraftwerk. It's basically a freeze frame.
I think I'm back. Huh?
Yeah, you are back.
I just got it until the Byrds and the 12-string guitar. I'm very sorry.
Okay, you can watch the replay and then argue like later when you're home. It doesn't really matter now. I think. So let's talk about influences. Let's talk about this. Okay. I like Kraftwerk. And I don't even know where to begin, because I don't even know what order these records came in. You know, I shouldn't even show this stuff because, you know, they can't even show their real faces here because they look like machines there. I mean,
it's not only that they look like machines, those are their machines. And in that time, they put machines on stage.
Of course they did. See, the thing about Kraftwerk, they don't even have to bother showing up.
Yeah, but you know, this was the whole concept of it. No? And sometimes I have been to a concert and the machines doesn't work. And so the whole concert has to be canceled.
Goes flippity-floppy. See, okay. I don't remember, do you remember in America? I think it was in Europe too. You know MTV, right? The network MTV. They had a series called Unplugged. Can you imagine if Kraftwerk was on Unplugged? I don't think that's gonna work.
Not possible, not at all. But okay, Maisie, but okay, yeah. Probably there will never be an Unplugged by Kraftwerk. But what does that say? That says nothing.
Look. Nothing. At least if the Beatles want dummies, they have Madame Tussauds Wax Museum dummies. So, you know, it depends. Which dummy band do you want? Do you want the Beatles? You know? I mean, we got Oasis. We got all the Britpop bands of the 80s and 90s, you know? How many Beatlesque? That's a term, Beatlesque. Beatlesque bands, pop bands, American, UK, German, very, you know, they call it Beatlesque.
From the Beatles, I know that there are a lot of cover bands. There are a lot of bands who play on the Jahrmarkt that only play Beatles songs, of course. But I think that doesn't say anything about the influence they have had on other musicians.
Okay.
First, Beatles, they started by doing music from other people.
Yes.
I think they have been forced to do it. You can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think—
You're absolutely right. You're absolutely right.
That was the point. And then when did they start to do own songs?
They were kind of writing a little earlier, but in terms of recording Love Me Do and that, and the reason they started doing it, because all these bands, everyone was in a band in Liverpool, the Merseyside, and they went to Hamburg, and they would sometimes go on, you know, these groups of bands playing on the same night, and they found that all these other groups were doing the same, you know, Little Richard songs, Chuck Berry songs. So instead of everyone doing their right songs, these same cover songs, John and Paul started writing their own. You know, so in 62, is when it really happens. Love Me Do, which I don't even think Love Me Do is a great song. That was like their first single. It's kind of like Love Me Do.
I really don't like Help, for example. I think Help is a terrible song for me personally. Okay, but that's not the topic of today.
Can you get close to the camera so you hear me or get to the microphone? You're wrong.
I'm wrong. Yeah, maybe I'm wrong, but that's my own thing. I don't like it. I don't like the whole rock and roll phase. I can't hear it. But that is not the topic. It's not about if I like them or what I like. It's about influence. And if you look at the music, the young people, not me, and probably not you, and not the boomers and the vinyl, old men, vinyl bearded men are listening to. I think the influence from Kraftwerk is much bigger than from the Beatles, much. Jay-Z, look at Jay-Z.
There's a good example. There's a good example, Jay-Z.
Jay-Z said, my biggest influence has been Kraftwerk.
He did say that?
Yeah. The whole Detroit techno scene, the whole Detroit techno scene is 80% Kraftwerk. And that's what I'm talking about, what makes Kraftwerk so important. I think the younger generations, the non-vinyl buyers, they really now get the fruits Kraftwerk put on in the 70s and early 80s.
Okay, now.
And so, of course.
Go ahead.
And of course, that we also could put other bands on this discussion, which are even probably haven't sold less than Kraftwerk. For example, Throbbing Gristle. I think Throbbing Gristle is such an important band.
I do too. Not as important as Kraftwerk or the Beatles, but an important band.
Yeah. They were very important.
And I saw them once, one of the times they came through San Francisco, and I've sent their albums. But it's unusual, but it did influence a lot of bands. Now, okay, yeah. So you tell me if I'm wrong. Kraftwerk made 8 records. Is that true?
I would say they made 7, but yeah, 8.
Okay. One's the mix. Right. And they did this in what, 40 years?
No. Okay, if you count the mix, but I think...
Take the mix one out.
Put the mix one, I think 12 years, within 12 to 15 years.
12 to 15 years, 7 albums.
Yeah.
Eight years, 13 records, albums, more or less. Now, and even before Kraftwerk was even a, the Beatles did 2 songs and they sung in German. Kann gib mir dein Hemd und sieb lieb dich.
Right.
That influenced countless young Germans to play guitar. And who kind of discovered the Beatles in Germany? 2 young Germans, Klaus Voormann, and Astrid Kircher.
Ah, I know her. I've seen a documentary. She was a photographer, wasn't she?
She was a photographer.
Yeah.
Who took these wonderful photographs in Germany. They started, and actually, okay, it was Astrid Kircher, who just passed away this past year, who is sort of credited to giving the Beatles their French haircuts, their German haircuts.
In the documentary, I remember that note. Now that you said,
Because, you know, she was in the avant-garde scene and the beatnik scene. It was her and Klaus Voormann, who later would play bass with several of them. And Stu Sutcliffe, the original bass player, and Astrid were hooked up, and that happened. So, but the influence, now, not only did the Beatles influence musically everyone, they influenced the culture and the look and long hair. And there was a certain wit and witticism about them at the time and humor. I don't remember people in the 70s going out to get Kraftwerk haircuts. Do you?
No, maybe the red shirts when they did the robots, but of course not. But that wasn't, you know, there's one, you started with something very important, and I don't know how important that was, that this was to Kraftwerk. Kraftwerk came after the Beatles, and I can imagine that they really wanted to get rid of the Beatles, of what the Beatles has done. And so you have to do things very differently. And the star cut, something like star cut, to have the right haircut, that wasn't their thing at all. Not at all. And maybe that has also something to do with the Beatles. I don't know that.
I don't know about this that much, because obviously you know a lot more about this band. Tell me about it. Tell me about these robots. I don't know anything about these robots.
Yeah, no, the idea of them was artificial music, electronic music. Music should be separated from the humans in a way. And then when it was possible, they built up their alter egos as machines. And those machines they put on stage, which of course also fits perfectly to the music. You know,
is this an original idea, do you think?
I haven't heard of other musicians who has done that.
Oh, that's funny. I happen to remember in 1967, the Beatles wanting to put a record out under the name Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. Let's pretend we're not the Beatles, but we're this other band, this alter ego, and let's come out and do something as Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band.
Yeah, but those are not machines, aren't they? Yeah. Mazzy, you... Nice. But I see there are still some differences between their programmed robots and the Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band.
Okay,
although I have to give you that, it's a good album.
It's a very good album. Explain this to me.
Yeah.
Following along the Beatles, I know you don't like their early rock and roll stuff, but let's say for the sake of argument, which is probably the case, Rubber Soul, all of a sudden they became more mature, maybe the End of Help, which you don't like, but Rubber Soul became more mature, and then Revolver and Sgt. Pepper. Every album was so different than the early Sgt. Pepper, Magic Mystery. Then the White Album was more, almost like I would call the White Album the Beatles indie record. You could argue it was disjointed, but it was so many different influences, Indian influences from obviously Sgt. Pepper, Within You, Without You, and conceptual and avant-garde with Revolution Number 9 in the Beatles. Now, if I take, again, I don't want to lift these up because they feel like big computers I'm lifting up, like all this computer crap. In a way, one album is exactly like the other album. There's not a lot of difference between these seven albums.
That's a very interesting point.
Always like bops and noises.
Imagine a person who hears all the Beatles albums, let's say starting Revolver until Let It Be, those albums. And this person hears pop music for the first time. This person probably says those are identical albums. You are very trained to hear the differences between Revolver, Abbey Road, Sgt. Pepper's, White Album, and on. You are very trained. That's completely driven. A non-trained person say, oh no, it's a nice song, but it's, well, no difference. And maybe you are not that trained when it comes to electronic music. And well, I understand.
I think you're absolutely right. I mean, because I grew up from, you know, 1964, I was 9, 10 years old when the Beatles come out in America. So for those 7, 8 years, I would experience my life to them. again, as I said, Autobahn, I hadn't heard anything before that. It was very unusual. It was one long song. And the only thing the only album I remember hearing about that, they weren't the first, but aside from, you know, long jams of rock and roll, like Canned Heat, Boogie, or mm-hmm. Cream doing...
Yeah, Gala La Vida, probably.
In a Gala La Vida, 1967 was one of the first. But the year before this, the one to me that's the closest, not musical style-wise, but that mm-hmm. came out of nowhere, whether you mm-hmm. like it or not now, is Tubular Bells by Mike Oldfield. Mm-hmm. That was so different. Yeah. It was an entire yeah. side. Yeah. And of course, in America, the next year, in actually the same year, I believe, Autobahn came out in 1974, when The Exorcist came out. The music was on The Exorcist soundtrack.
Most scariest movie of all time for me.
Me too. And that's, yeah, exactly.
But please let me get back one to finish this thinking. So, but if you are into electronic music, you have several albums. Let's take Radioactivity now. You have several albums, for example, Radioactivity, a whole subgenre of electronic music. You can put back to this Radioactivity album, even in my opinion, a lot of the dark ambient stuff. Then you have Trans-Europa Express. Again, a complete electronic subgenre goes back to just this album. Then go to the Mensch Machine, the Man Machine.
Up with you, it's so fast. I can't keep up with you, Michael. What the hell? Oh, look at how quaint is that?
Is it? I love it.
Oh, I don't have it here, but remember the Beatles in their suits and ties? You know, come on.
That's the Trans-Europa, it's the third album, yeah, yeah. But, you know, when it comes to Mensch Machine, the whole synth-pop genre is very much influenced by this album. Then you have Computer Welt, completely different. Then take now techno pop, industrial. You know, it's very different.
Hold on.
Boing, boom, chuck.
Okay, who came first here? Who influenced?
Come on, you have to give me more than four guys on a cover.
Who influenced too? Come on, Michael. Was ist das?
Okay, when it comes to the covers, Kraftwerk's covers are mediocre.
Actually, the covers are quite good. I like their covers a lot.
You like them?
I don't know. I do like them, actually, because they fit. Now, here's the thing. I like Kraftwerk, and as I've showed on my channel recently, Autobahn was the only one I got in 74, the first one, the American version promo, and I love that. I played it a lot. And you're right. We played that in the store, in a record store. And, you know, they didn't have this big, they had a cult following in the States, but they had a following. Every time we played that record in the store, we'd sell copies because people, you're right, they like, what is this? They hadn't heard that. It's kind of like when you play a bluegrass record back in the 70s or a classical record. Mm-hmm. A lot of buyers who were playing rock and roll then were kind of itching to hear something else, but they didn't take chances. They didn't know what to buy. So if you're playing something in the store, like a classical piece I remember in the mid 70s, was Pachelbel's Canon in D, which is, if anyone go to YouTube and just listen to that, even rock stations, there's a couple FM stations would play the Pachelbel's Canon in D. And it's about maybe an 8-10 minute piece, I don't even know. And it's just very catchy and very easy. It's kind of like Bolero, Ravel's mm-hmm. Bolero. You know, everybody liked Bolero because it was basically about sex and getting fucked, or fucking in a way, the buildup, the
whole rhythm.
Right. And people got into that. Of course, in the movie in the 80s, was it 10, that movie, the whole thing was Bolero, Ravel's Bolero. So people are dying for this. So playing Kraftwerk, was great, but I kind of got off the boat and lost interest. And I said before, there was a lot of these other groups coming, you're rightly so. And one that I went to see on a date was Gary Numan. And he had that hit, I forgot what, that was probably 1980.
Our friends Electric and Cars are probably his.
Yeah, Cars was the one, it was probably what, 81, 80?
Yeah. 80. Yeah, that was much later, but his real effort, his best song is Our Friends Electric.
I don't even know it, but I didn't get into Kraftwerk again until just recently with these reissues. And of course, because of you, I made a mistake and I should have talked to you beforehand. I bought all the English versions instead of the German, but you know, it doesn't matter. Now, another German collection here, this cover was designed by Klaus Vormann. Mm-hmm. Klaus Vormann, who played bass with Plastic Ono Band and worked on John's albums and George's albums and Ringo. Beautiful record, a beautiful cover art, you know? I mean, they helped.
My favorite Beatles record.
I will give it to you with early on with Astrid Kircher. And they were, even though they didn't know they were getting influenced by the whole German expressionist movement, you know? And to me, the difference between the two in a way is Kraftwerk is more Bauhaus. It's just more structured and monolithic and like like electronic and not as, it's not loose and soulful music, which doesn't mean it's a bad thing.
No. I'm thinking, is it really Bauhaus?
Maybe.
I understand why you say that, but yeah, of course. Yeah, you're right.
I think from a Western point of view, or not a Western, an American point of view, and I've been to Germany 3 times and not all of it, but there's a lot of that, you know, architecture that's almost like Soviet style, like Eastern Germany. I mean, that is
very, if I may interrupt you shortly, that's a very, very important part. The red and black are very important colors when it comes to Kraftwerk, which put them in some trouble here over in Europe, and because it's communism and fascism, the colors black and red. But that wasn't their point. That, of course, that was not the reason they did it.
These were my high school colors. We had, when I was in high school, I played soccer or what you would call football and ran track, and my high school color were red and black. I love red and black.
Yeah, of course.
The whole Soviet bloc and the, you know, especially, you know,
they use Russian language on their albums, which also was very, very impressive at the time that they did it.
So they were influenced by Russian, but you know something?
No, not influenced by Russian. I think that was I don't know the English word now.
What year was this? Do you know?
I have to, you know, I'm not that good with the fucking years.
You're definitely not that good. See, I know more about the Beatles than you know about fucking Kraftwerk.
Oh, I agree. I didn't write a book about Kraftwerk, Nancy.
Now, okay, this album, guess what opens this record? Back in the 78. Okay. Back in the USSR, Russian, before Kraftwerk had anything to do with Russia, back in the USSR. Now, during my previews, some friggin' communist made a comment that, you know, you're doing, I did my Kraftwerk versus Beatle thing, and I had to turn it off, and he thought I was looking at the cover to remember what friggin' band I was. But the problem with the White Album, you have to look at it because it's hard to see which way is up when it's just all blank white. But conceptual art, Richard Hamilton, the artist that did this, the Beatles, especially McCartney, was into that big conceptual art thing. Then of course, John Lennon got into it because of Yoko Ono and the Fluxus movement and that type of thing. So, you know, I don't even know what the connection is here. I don't know what the equivalent Kraftwerk album, there is no equivalent Kraftwerk album.
An equivalent to the White Album?
Yeah.
No. There is no equivalent.
They can't even come close to the White Album.
No, but Mezzi, you're always about this connections, and here are four men and there are four men. But honestly, we are talking about the influence,
right?
And the impact.
So always, you would, and I would agree with you if you agree with me. What I'm going to say is, David Bowie's Berlin trilogy are very influenced with Eno, and but very influenced by Kraftwerk and that German music, right? There you go.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And he said that those albums wouldn't exist in this form, to be careful, wouldn't exist in this form without Kraftwerk.
Right. I agree with that. I would agree with that. You know, I did, you know, I'm into a lot of, in fact, I did a little video, a feature video on a gentleman by the name of, what's his name? The electronic guy, Manhattan Research Incorporated, Raymond Scott. And Raymond Scott was a band leader, a writer in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. He even did radio jingles, but he experimented with, you know, Moog synthesizer and electronic Manhattan Research and experimental jazz type stuff. And my guess is Kraftwerk also was influenced by people like him. Of course, in America, in 1968, we had Walter Carlos's Switched on Bach. And that was it. I mean, of course, it's Bach music too. All of a sudden, people like my age were buying this classical masterworks Columbia Bach record because it was on a synthesizer and it was huge. And then of course his music, Walter Carlos's music, who later transgendered to Wendy Carlos, was used in A Clockwork Orange, the Beethoven, the Ninth Symphony, and Wagner in that too. So that was 72. So that was 2 years before Autobahn. My guess is Kraftwerk was influenced by Walter Carlos as well. I don't know if that's the case.
I cannot confirm that. I know what is confirmed is that they have been influenced by Stockhausen and this music concrete thing. That is for sure. But if you know Stockhausen and Albin Lucier, they all probably knew him too, of course. They didn't, of course.
At least of him, because that music, especially back then, was not in a vacuum. In fact, you know, the Moog synthesizer, there weren't a lot of people that had Moog synthesizers. In fact, George Harrison got one, and ironically, is Mickey Dolenz of the Monkees got one of the first Moog synthesizers and used it on one of their records early on as well. So they were kind of futzing around with this stuff and they didn't really know what to do with it. You know, Abbey Road, there's a Moog synthesizer on parts of Abbey Road as well.
Is it? Okay, yeah. Which song?
Here Comes the Sun at the very beginning.
After our video, we'll go in here.
Yeah, and side two also. There's some stuff on side two. There's other bits of it. But you know what's nice about it? I'm so happy they didn't overuse it, because some bands are just, you know, like Emerson, Lake and Palmer, that first song, "Oh Lucky Lucky Man," which I like, but the very end of it, they're going all those, you know, type of noise.
Also, for me, Emerson, Lake and Palmer, sometimes you have to be in the right mood to hear Emerson, Lake and Palmer. I can't put it on every day.
So do you see an influence or an overlapping between Kraftwerk and some of the prog bands that were coming out in the early 70s? King Crimson, obviously Keith Emerson.
I think when it comes to the very early Kraftwerk albums, the first four albums, which are not into the canon nowadays. We say, no, those are not Kraftwerk, but this krautrock, this improvisational albums, I think they have been influenced. I'm quite sure. But they made this big cut when it comes to Autobahn. They invented themselves all over again in a way. But I have another question. Maybe you can help me out. What I always ask myself when it comes, for example, especially to the Beatles, how important that we talk nowadays so much about the Beatles, how important is this notorious 500 top album list from the Rolling Stones for the Beatles?
You know, it's so subjective. I'm not a big fan of those lists. And I know,
where I'm getting to,
I understand. It's funny. I keep getting asked by people who know me or even a, like, how come I didn't make a Beatle channel on YouTube or a Beatle channel in the vinyl community, as much as I love the Beatles? And, you know, as we all know, and I don't know if anyone, if a Beatle fans or you're watching this, there are a lot of Beatle fans and a lot of Beatle channels, and they do it well at different levels and different points of view. And it's very personal. And I'm that generation. I'm a first generation. So I certainly could have done one of a Beatle fan and talking about it. But this is the thing. The Beatles influence me on so many kinds of music. We're talking about the influence of the Beatles, not me as the musician, but as a human, as a music lover, as a lover of pop culture. The Beatles turned me on to country music with, you know, their early, like, Act Naturally and the covers they did early on. I don't want to spoil the party, so I'll go. They introduced me to world music with George Harrison introducing the sitar and getting into Ravi Shankar. They introduced me to the avant-garde and synthesizers. You know, they introduced me to the point with synthesizers so I can like someone like Kraftwerk, you know, years later. They opened me up, and I just did a Beethoven's 250th birthday. Help, Beethoven's ninth. The Beatles introduced me to classical music, and I gravitated to Wagner and Beethoven and the likes, and avant-garde Fluxus movement with Yoko Ono. So they opened the floodgates to me musically, even into little piano things on You Know My Name, Look at the Number, the little jazzy piano thing. Like, that's kind of cool. I know jazz, but it's I mean, the Beatles doing jazz is nothing like, you know, Herbie Hancock or anyone else doing jazz or UB Blake or anything. But, you know, they're listening to trad jazz stuff there, and it's really with a saxophone on that. But those top records, but some people, some Beatle freaks are upset now because Sgt. Pepper's not a number one anymore. It doesn't really matter. Yeah,
because that was the next step I want to talk about. They did it, they renewed it in 2020. They did a lot of this political correctness stuff, I think. But also the big loser with the new list are the Beatles.
Well, I don't think it's a loser.
When we strictly talk about the numbers, you know, there's only one album now in the top 10. I think it's
Sgt. Pepper.
Abbey Road.
Abbey Road, right. Okay. I don't remember.
Only Abbey Road on place 8, I think.
Well, I think they have a whole, first of all, there's a new generation and a diversity of voters who are voting and editors and writers. Yes. So of course they're going to be into whether it's Kanye West or Beyonce, and rightly so, there should be.
Right, exactly. I think we have to, you know, when we see the sales numbers on vinyl, we have Beatles, Pink Floyd, Led Zeppelin. And in a way, that's terrible.
Terrible. I think it there's classic record. Now, you've...
That's terrible. I think we need more people, more variety also in the vinyl scene. That's what I'm saying. I think those are not terrible records.
My list of 21 my favorite albums. Now, there's a lot of new music not there, but there's a lot of music there. And I find that the people I know outside of the vinyl community that I've known for years, they look at my list and they have, except for Bob Dylan and maybe three other records, they have no idea what I'm talking about. And then I see other lists and there's all these artists that I don't know about. And I love that.
Yeah.
McCartney, you asked me how I like the McCartney 3 record. I like it. I don't love it. And I've only heard it 3 times yet. I think it's great that he's making music and it's a lockdown record. And, you know, are we going to make, maybe because of all the hype and the promotion they're doing, is it more of the promotion than it really is? It's a nice record. Would it made my top 20? Probably not. It would have probably just missed it. Although I really like it a lot and it gets better. But it's not this, you know, I have no problem in putting the Beatles to a backseat of things in some music, like we're talking about Kraftwerk. Because look at, in 2000, the 2000 to 2010, that decade, the early aughts, the number one selling album of that entire decade was the Beatles' One Comp.
Not Adele? Okay.
No, The Beatles won. Adele probably, I don't know if she came after 2010. I can't remember. But no, but if she came out toward the tail end of that decade, maybe. I don't remember. The Beatles won comp. Because first of all, CDs were still happening. And all of a sudden, there's this one record with all, more or less, all the singles, all their number one singles, with a couple of exceptions. And you could buy it in supermarkets and you know, in bookstores and Starbucks and whatever. And it just, everybody just would grab a copy, like grabbing the newspaper or the tabloids at your supermarket. It was everywhere. But so they still...
It's unbelievable with the Beatles, but not in a bad way. Don't get me wrong. In a way, they deserved it. But come on, I think sometimes it's a bit too much. They are
okay. Do you know what
I think? No, please let maybe you agree with me. I think they are so over the top with the Beatles. It's too much. They are not that good.
They are, because people still buy their records and listen to their records. And okay, here's a good thing about influences.
Okay.
You know, I'm going to look here. I'm going to ask Siri. Hey, Siri, how many covers songs of the Kraftwerk's Autobahn are there?
Okay. I found this on the web for how many covers songs of the Kraftwerk's Autobahn are there. Check it out.
I can't find it. Are there covers of songs by Kraftwerk?
Messi, excuse me, but now you've made a big mistake.
Ask Siri,
how many loops or parts of Kraftwerk songs has been used in the last 20 years in top 10 songs?
Oh, sampling? You mean sampling?
Sampling, thank you. Unbelievable.
I don't know the answer to that. You tell me. Tell me what you want.
Probably in the thousands. Because and those are big problems, because in Germany alone, Kraftwerk made so many lawsuits because of that fact. Afrika Bambaataa uses, I don't remember which one, for his most famous song, he used Kraftwerk samples. Coldplay.
Not World World Domination, not the one with Johnny Lydon. No.
But Coldplay, they have those samplings.
That's a good example.
Forget that. We have to cut that code, but of course they did.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. But that's very, very huge in the hip hop scene, those Kraftwerk samples.
Oh,
a lot.
Sure.
And they're legion.
So are there parts and pieces more valuable, more popular than the whole?
No, but this is a good question. This is the way music has developed, that you use parts and pieces. And I think that Kraftwerk has a lot to do with that fact that music has gone in that direction.
I want to see Miley Cyrus cover the entire 23 minutes of Autobahn.
She would never do, but she probably would take 5 seconds.
She should cover the whole thing. I would pay for that album. Everybody, Miley Cyrus, if you're listening, do an EP, entire cover of Autobahn, 23 minutes.
Miley Cyrus, if you're looking on Mezzi's channel and not mine, I'm very disappointed.
Okay. I didn't even know we got Comet Medley, Midnight, and Morning Walk. Four different...
On the Autobahn, yeah?
Autobahn. I did not know that.
I like the second side more than Autobahn, by the way.
Okay, so we got 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 15, 19, 20 minutes or so of Autobahn.
Yeah, 20. I think 22.
Autobahn, fun. Is there an English version of that? I guess not, huh?
No. There's only one version, but maybe I tell you shortly why I recommend the German versions. I think the German versions with the German language, it fits better it suits better to the music at all. And I think that the German versions have the better shapes of the master tapes. I think they are not so stressed out like the English ones. And also from this Tour de France, there's only one version. There are not two versions.
As far as I see here, except for the American version, not one album of Kraftwerk is outside. And this is an illustration. It's not even really outside. So the Kraftwerk can't even get outside because...
No, they are not the outside boys.
You would need a generator because there's not a plug extension cord long enough to follow them on the Autobahn. Where the Beatles, look at the Beatles, right here is Abbey Road Studios. So they're only like, you know, maybe 100, 150 feet away from the recording studio. But
now that you say that, you are absolutely right. The Beatles are the much more influential band because they walk across the street.
And they walk in front of a German Volkswagen Beetle.
Probably the Kraftwerk boys are inside that one.
Okay, I think we should wind it up now. We don't want this to go on too long. Any last minute things? I mean, I actually like Kraftwerk, and I've in the last few weeks, I've gotten a whole new appreciation for that. I tell you what surprised me, getting all these reissues, and this is like a cliche thing when we talk about vinyl, especially because I got them all on vinyl. I was surprised, and again, I don't know about mixes, remixes, remasters, all that, because I don't have, and it doesn't matter to me with this band for me, but I was surprised how warm these records are, because you always think of metallic and electronic stuff as being icy cold, but they're really kind of it's almost organic. I hate to say that for me. I was surprised how organic I reacted to these Kraftwerk
records. At least for the first three albums.
So I don't even know what order they are, except for Autobahn. I have no idea what order these came out in.
Mm. But when, I don't know that's why I asked. When the only album in America that was bigger was Autobahn, not Radioactivity. No Radioactivity.
All the Radioactivity and Tour de France and the one where they copied the Beatles on the album cover. I think this one, Technopop, was kind of beat, you know. And I keep thinking of, we wouldn't have U2's Pop without this album, right? Is it called Pop? I forgot that they did that kind of German electronic, except I like Zeropa. Zeropa is a good album, and that's very influenced by this too. I don't know, because I kind of pulled away from this electronic music in the later 70s. It was out there. I was selling the records. We sold a lot of them. You know, they had a cult following. They sold, but I wasn't following that whole scene, except when I would start going to the clubs at night, whether it's, you know, the punk clubs or the gay clubs or the, you know, in San Francisco, we had all these gay clubs, but the gay clubs would switch over to new wave music. So you'd have these new wave bands play, you know, it would start out dancing, then the new wave bands would tour from the UK and probably techno bands. And then, you know, after the bands at midnight would finish, it would be dance clubs again all night. So straight people would go.
But then the whole synth pop thing came, or was that you also went to clubs when the synth pop?
Yeah,
thing
I remember came? Going to clubs and hearing a lot. Like, I don't know who I listened to, but you had all the synthesizer drum, you know, Giorgio Moroder, all.
Yeah, but maybe you know Front 242, Blanc Mange.
I've heard of them. I don't know. The thing about that music, I heard him a lot. I'd go dance to him. I'd listen to the stuff.
717, A Human League, you probably know.
Do You Want Me Baby was huge.
That was huge hit, of course.
It was huge here. 1980.
Do you remember Being Boiled?
I've never been boiled in my entire life.
No, but you have to get into Being Boiled. And this is so Kraftwerk in a way.
Sounds creepy.
It is, but a great song. You will love it.
But I would listen to that music and go to clubs and parties. You're right. I'd go to parties where they'd have lights and stuff going, and electronic music was everywhere. It was such, especially in the 80s, if it wasn't, you know, the post-punk stuff or the stuff you talked about, like Throbbing Gristle, Young Marble Giants, which I like, which is more minimal, not as electronic, but all that stuff was very popular. But I wasn't buying it a lot on records and taking it home. I liked it when I was out at a party or a club, but I didn't listen to it on my turntable at home.
There were the Beatles.
Well, I mean, but as you know, as people follow my channel, I got into all these other bands. Watch my, those of you, and those of you who are watching this on Michael's RPM, 45 RPM audiophile channel, subscribe to me too. I have an autobiographical series of memories of
best part. Those are the best videos in the BC.
Well, it's my own therapy, but I talk about, I think I have a 1980 and a 1984 one. You'll see what I'm into. There's not a lot of electronic music in, but there were a lot of bands. Like I was in Echo and the Bunny Man and Psychedelic Furs and that kind of stuff in the UK and the punk, post-punk stuff. The Beef.
Yeah, okay. Again, Mezzi. There are also so influential bands, Joy Division, records, but how
New Order, New Order.
The Beatles, but so important. I don't think that New Order is that important. I think Joy Division is the most important of
the
those.
First New kind Order of. Record I love, and then after that, they bored me personally.
Yeah, right, absolutely, you're right.
Right.
Ecstasy, don't underestimate Ecstasy, by the way, you love them.
I love Ecstasy, and they're very Beatles-esque. They're so influenced by
them. Yeah, they are.
Very. I mean, you know, Todd Rundgren, all these people are influenced by the Beatles. I think if they got your point.
No doubt about it. I've said it in the beginning and I say it now in the end. Beatles is a very important band, but there are others like Kraftwerk. And I think when it comes to the music nowadays, the impact of Kraftwerk is larger nowadays than the Beatles.
Let's pick one record that shows good to hold up at the end of this video.
Can only be one.
Tilt it a little bit. You get there. Thanks for watching, everybody.
Thank you.
Mazzy loves you.
Bye.